call to order the August 1st, 2016 Board of Commissioners meeting. Just had a work session at 5 o'clock for substantial damage and disaster assessment relative to the flood insurance program. With that, I will ask the Reverend Jerry Cribb, Pillmore United Methodist Church, to lead us in the invocation and the Pledge of Allegiance. All stand, please.
Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for the many ways in which you manifest your presence and your power in our lives each and every day. We come boldly before you, giving you thanks for this great land in which we live, for the many benefits that you provide for us day in and day out. We also give you thanks for this part, for Currituck County, for those who are in leadership, for those whom you have given the privilege of leading and guiding the government of this county. We thank you for all those residents who are part of this county. And God, we pray now that your heavenly wisdom and presence might rule over this commissioner's meeting today and always. Bless now this time together. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, sir. Okay, the second order of business we're going to have is the approval of the agenda. I have two items that I want to. One is to remove item A under public hearing. It's PB 16-14, large residential structures, and I would like to add closed session at the end of the meeting.
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Second that motion.
All in favor?
Aye.
Yes, sir.
As you open that for discussion, I have a question.
Sure.
On public hearings item A about large structures, what is the chair's plan with that agenda item? We've removed it. What is the action the board plans on taking next?
General conversation has been, and I'm open to any kind of further advice, is to have discussion with staff to see what sort of time is necessary to address any of the outstanding concerns or issues that have been brought to our attention, and then look for staff guidance as to when to reschedule that. But I'm open to any suggestion.
Well, the reason I ask is I've been contacted on by people on both sides of this issue asking if you remove it, what's next? Are you going to take it back out to the public for further input? Or are we just going to schedule it at next agenda? What is the next step for this particular item?
Well, my understanding, I believe the rest of the commissioners have had conversations similar to mine, is that there has been some questions brought up relative to the affect in certain areas that may have had unintended consequences relative to the overall application of this. We need to look into that. And there's been further questions that have been brought up from a segment of, I think, the building and event people that would like to have some input as well or some guidance. Now, with that, are there any other comments? Because I know probably most of us have been contacted.
Yes, Mr. Chair, just a comment as well. I have received some phone calls for some individuals, saw this for the first time, and have not had a chance to really get into it and digest it and write some questions down and get some feedback from staff. So, I would agree that, as was stated by the chairman, to allow some time, whether it's, I don't know, do we want to set a time limit for a couple of weeks, maybe a month to come back before the board?
I don't know
if the staff feels that might.
Well, Mr. Chairman, what I recommend, had a series of community meetings over the last year that we used as a base to to assemble the language that is being presented to you tonight. What we unfortunately did not have time to do or did not do was to vet out the final recommended proposal in front of the board through a community meeting. So I would recommend that the staff have the opportunity to schedule a meeting in Corolla where we'll take this final language back out and let all the interested parties come and make comment on it, and then we can schedule it at a future date to bring it back to the Board of Commissioners. But it'll probably be something in the next 2 or 3 weeks we could try to put something together for a public meeting.
Okay, is that sufficient?
That sounds like a great idea.
Good. Alrighty, so you brought up discussion. We brought it up to vote. I got halfway through it when I said
I'm in favor.
All in favor, aye. Opposed?
Aye.
None in opposition. Motion passes unanimously. All right. Next item we have before us this evening is administrative reports. It's Animal Services and Control Department report. Ms. Gina Maurer, Director.
Good evening. I just wanted to give you a quick on what your Animal Services and Control Department has accomplished and our successes. We've had a lot going on. We hit the ground running and we've never stopped. We had our first advisory board meeting on July 7th. It was a very positive meeting, and we had lots of great ideas for volunteer orientation. We spoke about the dog park, the location of that, educating adopters and the public. And at this time, I'd like to publicly thank the members of our board for their dedication and their time and energy for the animals and for our department. We just have a great group of people, and it means a lot to us. Our next meeting is this Thursday, August 4th, and we're going to speak about fall adoption events and community involvement. And we're looking forward to making great things happen in this community for the animals and community involvement as well. We have been updating and posting events, shelter stories, and pictures on our Facebook and our Happy Tales. And I hope you guys are all following us on our Facebook so you can keep in touch and know what we're doing. Just wanted to follow up or touch base. We had our first, we had a report in the Focus, and we've been working with Randall. We've already received lots of positive feedback from the public. Citizens stated that the article was very informative and that they appreciated the transparency, as this information hasn't been published or publicly shared in the past. After the article in the Focus, the shelter did see an influx of donations and volunteers, and those numbers continue to go up. I think a lot of that has to do with the summer and people are on vacation and that kind of thing, but we really appreciate the volunteers and the people of this community that either donate their time or monetary or whatever they can for the shelter. I hope that all of you guys have read this article. Randall did he did a great job, and we'll continue to share and inform the citizens of this community, and we continue to be transparent. Just a quick update on the events. The last couple months since the Focus, we've had Kids First events. We've had several adopt-a-thons at the Tractor Supply, in which we had a lot of donations. We came back with a truckload of dog food and cat litter and toys and that kind of thing. And we did get some monetary donations, and we've gone to the Tractor Supply in Elizabeth City, and there's the one in Chesapeake. Some of the staff has gone. We went to a sheltering class, which I found very informative, but it was a really good day, and we learned a lot. We have done several adoption events at PetSmart, and we also have 2 cat cages up there that we continue to maintain and adopt out. We get a good number of cats out through either our adoption events or our cages up there. We also entertained and partnered with the YMCA for the summer camp kids. We had crafts, and they did a lot of animal enrichment with the dogs and cats. We've had several transports. We did one with the Humane Society, and if you follow us on Facebook, you will see that. We just transferred 13 puppies. The Humane Society has partnered with Pets Plus out of Pennsylvania, and it's to stop puppy mills, so they're pulling animals and puppies from shelters instead of supporting puppy mills. So we're part of that pilot program, and I'm very proud of that. Also, it's kitten season, so we have many, many cats at the shelter. If anyone wants to come adopt a baby, we have beautiful adoptable cats and dogs. Our numbers right now are 10 cats to every one dog. So we have a lot of kitties that we need to find homes for. So that's why we appreciate the community and also our PetSmart and our Adopt-a-thons and our volunteers to help us find forever homes for our babies. I didn't know if you guys had any questions or comments.
Yeah, I just want one comment, Gene. I did stop by there a few weeks back, and I just did a quick tour, and I just want to commend you for how you're keeping the shelter looking. It looked very nice and clean. Everything seems good. And I found out about that, the puppies and the dogs in the Pennsylvania, and I talked to some of the staff in there and how much you're being able to get those dogs homes or moved them to get potential homes, and I think that sounded like they were very happy, and I think that was a very good, successful program. And I did find out too that the kitty population has been booming.
Sure you saw.
But I just wanted to say thank you for the work you guys have done there in the shelter so far. It does look nice, and I've heard a lot of good things.
I also failed to mention we did transfer six dogs to Delaware as well. So we did the puppies with the Pets Plus, and then we did we transferred six adult dogs to Delaware SPCA. So we're working really hard to get these babies out. If you guys don't have any more questions or comments, I would like to at this time introduce Donna Corbo. She's our chair for the Animal Services Advisory Board, and I think she has a couple things to say. Thank you.
I was going to have just one comment, if I could, and it's on a personal note. My family, actually my son and my wife, went to the animal shelter here, I think about a month and a half or so ago, to adopt a dog to replace one that we had lost. It couldn't have been nicer. They came home. You guys just treated them outstanding. I wasn't sure what they brought home at first was a dog. I mean, they said it was. I mean, it had all the necessary parts. But I was used to my 13-year-old dog, and this was like a 2-year-old child and whatever. But the bond has taken, and he's becoming best buds. But the experience was outstanding for them, and I want to thank you for that.
Well, thank you. Thank you so much.
Good evening. Again, I'm Donna Corbo. And first, I want to thank you all for appointing me to the advisory committee. I feel very honored and privileged to be a voice for the animals in our county because I just love Currituck so much. And to reiterate what Gina said, we did have our first meeting and on July 7th, and we appointed a chair and a vice chair. We are very excited about moving forward. We had a lot of great ideas, and we will be meeting quarterly on the first Thursday of each quarter. Except for we're going to be meeting this Thursday, but then starting September, we're going to go quarterly, September and December, March, and then June. So that would be the first Thursday. And also, also to reiterate what Gina said, if anybody would like to volunteer, they always, it's so hot out, and a lot of the dogs have to stay, well, they have to stay inside because it's so hot, and they need to get walked. So if you know of anybody or anyone's listening, just go up to the shelter, just get a dog, and make, I mean, it would be the best day for that dog. Just, I mean, it might be really hot for y'all, but they just need to get out. And I've got a lot of foster kitties, too, in my house, so if anybody wants to come over and pick one out. But thank you again.
Thank you.
Ladies, again, because I'm the commissioner on the Animal Shelter Advisory Board, I just want to thank each one of you guys that are serving on that advisory board. This group is excited, and it was very interesting to hear that each one of them, as we went around and kind of introduced ourselves and where our passion and where we thought the most help could be was the education piece. Every single person on that board is on board with getting additional information and education out, because that's the key for adopt-a-thons, for the adopters, for volunteers. So they've got some great ideas and some great programs coming up to really help the fur babies of the county. And there was an exotic animal in there too, which, you know, I wasn't too keen on when we said that we were going to the exotic room, but it happened to be a bunny rabbit. So I was all okay then. So I wasn't sure what to expect there. So, you know, we do have an exotic room, but it doesn't necessarily mean it's, you know, a definition of an exotic animal. But thank you again.
Thank you.
And I just want to tell you all, you've done a great job, Ms. Maurer, Ms. Corbo. We appreciate what you're doing. And I hear nothing but great things, and keep it up.
Thank you. Also, what time is that meeting, by the way?
Seven.
Thank you.
Gina, just like to share with you, I had the opportunity to talk with and meet someone the other day that knows some people that, if I called their names, everyone would know very well, but they don't live around here, but they visit here, and they have been very active and donating money and funds and stuff for dog parks and care for animals and stuff. And we got talking a little bit about the dog park and part of a project that we're trying to get put together. And she has offered to make some contact with these folks and see if maybe we could leverage them a little bit to help us out some. But I will keep you informed.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, folks. All right. Next on the agenda under public hearings, it's public hearing and action, PB 16-10, Currituck County UDO Housekeeping 2016. This is a request to amend the Unified Development Ordinance, Chapter 2, Administration, Chapter 4, Use Standards, Chapter 5, Development Standards, Chapter 6, Subdivision and Infrastructure Standards, Chapter 7, Environmental Protection, and Chapter 10, Definitions and Measurements. With that, Mr. Woody.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This is basically an omnibus text amendment, and what we do about once a year is we track changes that are needed in the UDO, and in this housekeeping amendment, as we call it, we try to bring forward changes that are not controversial or not substantive. So we want to bring forward an amendment about once a year that basically corrects typos and incorrect cross-references. So there shouldn't be a lot in this amendment that really has any change in legislative intent. But nonetheless, I want to run through these 10 items very quickly and see if you have any questions. The first item, I'm going to go through these 1 through 10, one at a time. Item 1. Changes the planning board member's term from 3 years to 2 years, which is consistent with the ordinance adopted by the commissioner several years ago. Item 2 is changing or correcting the acronym for the MXR zoning district. It was listed as RMX, which is incorrect. Item 3 is changing the way in which the county calculates an acre for a mine. If you mine 1 acre or less in area, you are not subject to a state permit. If you mine more than an acre, you are subject to a state permit. The county was not including the haul roads in our calculation, and the state was, which was causing situations where you wouldn't need a county permit, and then the applicant would think they were good with the state when they weren't. So we've corrected this to make sure that when we calculate an acre and when our staff tells people an acre, that includes the haul road, which is the same way the state does it. So this basically makes our 1 acre permit consistent with the state's exemption, so we don't cross communicate with applicants anymore. The homeowners association, right now we require that a subdivider transfer common areas, facilities, infrastructure to the association at 75% of lot sales. There's one reference in the ordinance that's still referred to 51%, so we've corrected that one reference to be at 75 to be consistent with the rest of the ordinance concerning homeowners associations. Item 5, utility lines. Our utility department has asked us to clarify that utility lines should be put in separate trenches. That's what we've done in this amendment. In the past, we actually encouraged utility lines to be in the same trench, and what that leads to is if work's being done on one utility, they may interrupt or bust or hurt the other utility line in the same trench. So this just kind of cleans everything up. And my understanding is utilities don't like to put their lines in the same trench anyways. Item 6 clarifies that conservation subdivisions are subject to the external street connectivity. So as the board knows, the staff's always pushing connectivity among different developments. The way the ordinance was actually written is inadvertently is conservation subdivisions were actually not subject to connectivity, which we think obviously was a mistake. And we've had connectivity in the subdivisions the whole time we've had this ordinance in place. We're asking that to be corrected. Item 7 is a parking requirement. We have a parking requirement for flea markets that was unclear. It actually said that you had to have a parking space for every 200 square feet of use area. So that means if you had an acre of land that was a flea market, you would have to put a parking space in for every 200 square feet, which would be somewhat ridiculous. So what we've done is clarified that to say what it used to say in the ordinance is that you have one parking space for every 200 square feet of building area plus three spaces for each outdoor stand or rented space. So that brings the flea market parking in line a little more with what it used to be and makes a little more sense.
Mr. Woody?
Yes, sir.
Could I just interject on that item 7? How would that affect, I believe there's a flea market in the Grandy area.
Correct.
Okay, there's no, I mean, that's just a field parking.
Are you going
to go by acreage on that or something for parking?
Well,
or?
Yeah, they actually, they should be under violation at this point.
I didn't want to put them now. I just.
Well, that's why this.
I just wonder how you define the parking for something like that. Okay.
Yeah, they're actually not operating that in the area that they were approved to operate it in. So hopefully that will be corrected soon. Now, they've gotten permission to have a flea market set up there. They're just not operating it consistent with the plans that were approved. So we're working on that.
Okay, so you're working with them just to make sure.
Correct.
Okay, because I didn't want to stop. I just want to make sure.
No, that's what we noticed.
Because that's just a field parking. I don't know how you're going to.
Yeah, and I think when the way the standard was originally written, they were going to have to do like 70 or 80 parking spaces, right, and it was just a handful of vending booths. Now, they got to give them the right place, but this kind of corrects that situation. And item 8 is a clarification. In our heavy industrial or heavy manufacturing zoning district, in one place in the ordinance, we allow asphalt and concrete plants and heavy manufacturing. In the definition, we actually say they're not allowed. So obviously, that's a conflict. The intent of heavy manufacturing is to allow concrete and asphalt plants. So what this does is deletes the improper reference in the definition and leaves the reference in the other section of the ordinance, again, to allow concrete and asphalt plants in the HI or the heavy manufacturing zoning district. Lighting. We have lighting standards in Currituck County. Those currently reference watts, but what we found is that wattage for LED lights is much different than wattage for incandescent lights. So what this does, it's converting the wattage to lumens, which is a more appropriate way to measure light levels in today's technology, advanced technology world. So we're just kind of updating the way we measure light levels to lumens instead of watts. But it doesn't change the light level itself, just how it's measured. Stormwater management, item 10, is a number of changes. One is we have a situation where oftentimes major subdivisions, commercial subdivisions, are permitted by the state, and as part of that, the state establishes allowable lot coverages and stormwater management systems. Right now, our ordinance is making the developer of that individual lot go back in and put more stormwater on the individual lot. We've created an exemption that allows the county to recognize the stormwater system that was permitted through the state approval process and through the subdivision approval process, and basically not make a commercial property do a second stormwater management system on top of what they've already done through the subdivision. So that exemption is included in this. Also in stormwater management standards, we clarify, this is technical, but we have a requirement that a building pad be elevated above the 24-hour storm event with a 10-year reoccurrence, which means basically our stormwater will rise to a certain level and the building pad has to be 18 inches above that. We used to also reference the base flood elevation, as we talked about earlier tonight. We've struck that because if you're 18 inches above the base flood elevation, you're typically going to meet the requirement, or if you're 1 foot above the base flood elevation, you will typically meet the requirement for the building pad elevation. So we've basically just left the reference to the building pad elevation in there because, again, remember the flood requirements you have to meet no matter what. So it doesn't need to be restated in the stormwater ordinance. That's a complicated change, but the takeaway is is we removed a reference that's not correct. Easements, the county has added some language to better define how easements are measured. What it does, it clarifies that when you have an easement, you measure it from the top of the embankment. So if the county requires a 25-foot easement on a ditch, the purpose of the easement is to allow equipment to get in there to do work on the ditch, to clean it, whatever it is, and the easement should be measured from the top of the embankment where the equipment can operate, not from the center of the ditch. So we just wanted to clarify where that easement is measured. And then that's for both major ditches and minor ditches. And that is, oh, and there's one incorrect cross-reference in the stormwater section that was also changed. That's the 10 items that we are proposing to be modified, and obviously staff recommends approval, and I can answer any questions you have. Oh, excuse me, the planning board heard this at their last meeting, and the planning board also recommended approval of this with a unanimous vote.
Any questions? Mr. Woody, I just a couple questions for clarification. Item 3 for mining the Hall Road. It's been my understanding that in the past there was a significant number of ponds in Currituck that were acre or less that didn't get a state permit. And it wasn't until recently, I think a year or so ago, when we had a conversation, I think that came out. Inasmuch now as they have to get a county permit that's going to have the Hall Road incorporated, do you anticipate an impact on where these one-acre ponds will be allowed? And for clarification, I'm asking, if the Hall Road is included, you have an acre, then you have on-site where you have to set aside where the dirt can be stored. So you never get an acre pond. You always get less.
Correct.
Regardless of whether or not there's a Hall Road. Obviously, the farther off of the road, i.e. the longer the Hall Road, the less of a pond you're going to have. Now, right. Maybe an unintended consequence or something can come from this is that we're forcing all these, or limiting, if you will, one-acre ponds close proximity to the roads and precluding the ability, because of the Hall Road subtraction, to have anything. Have you thought about that? I mean, when I was looking at this, it just came to my mind.
I have, but I think the state already limits. I mean, in some ways, the state's already saying that if you disturb more than an acre, including the Hall Road, you're subject to the full state mining permit process. So I think the challenge is that people read the county ordinance and think the Hall Road's excluded and feel like they're in good shape to go ahead and just do a mine. And then one day the state shows up on their property and says, no, you've actually over-excavated. So I don't disagree with your point. It probably is going to, not including the – if you include the Hall Road, I do agree that it's going to put the mines probably closer to the paved access road. But at the same time, that should already be happening, because most people who do a one-acre pond don't want to get state permits. That's really probably one of the purposes they do them that small.
And the only reason I bring it up is because here we go again. This is the way we've always done it, and we're – got a lot of one-acre ponds all over the county, and the understanding is don't need to count the hall. Now they're going to have to.
Yeah.
So I'm just asking.
Again, they should be doing that anyways, because really when they do that, when they don't count the Hall Road, they're actually, if they're at an acre or over an acre, they're out of compliance with state law. So I feel like in a way we're just aligning ourselves, Currituck County, with what the state's already required.
I'm not disagreeing with what you're – I'm just looking at the consequences of doing that will kind of sort of eliminate one-acre ponds at a certain distance off of the main paved road. I'm not saying that's a good thing, bad thing. I'm just pointing out the consequence of this, not disagreeing that we shouldn't have been doing it.
No. Now, from a homeowner perspective, if you don't have a Hall Road, so if you dig a pond – for material or for maybe your house pad or whatever, you're going to be okay, because in that sense you're not building a Hall Road anyways. So I mean, in some ways what this does is probably it will put more commercially type operated 1 acre mines closer to the road. I do agree with you on that, but if you're not hauling material for commercial purpose and you're digging the pond for your own property, you're probably okay still at the full acre.
It's kind of ironic. On one hand, we offer incentive programs to clean up the corridor. And on the other hand, we're telling people to dig ponds or mining operations closer to the road where it can be seen. Whew, boy. And I understand it's not the county. I understand that. But, I mean, it's just...
I mean, the board could... I mean, the board could require even a less than an acre of mine to go through a special use permit process.
I don't want to do that. That's even... But it's just kind of... I mean, so what you're saying is someone wants... The farmer wants to dig a pond for a fish pond.
Yeah.
Half a mile off the road, three-quarters of an acre in size. He would be exempt from the haul road piece of it and could still do that.
I think it depends on what he did with the material. If he were selling the material and it was truly hauling it out of the site, then I think the state's going to look at that as acreage. I feel like if he were using the material on his site somehow, then there's probably some ability to...
In essence, this is for commercial mining pits.
Basically, yeah. I mean, if it's a haul road, you're hauling material out of the site, so...
Is the state now actively involved in permitting these one-acre or less ponds?
I would say they're actively involved in finding ponds that are just over an acre, which is why this came. I mean, they came and they rode. They do inspections periodically, and they found probably six or seven mines that were maybe a little less, maybe five or six mines that were over an acre. But a number of those folks had permits from the county for less than an acre pond, which, again, we were looking at the haul road differently. Each organization was, so.
And the only reason I brought it up has just come to me, the unintended consequence pushing the one-acre ponds closer to the paved road and precluding the possibility, unless you go commercial, larger than 1 acre, the farther away you get. That's all.
I mean, that's probably an outcome to this. That's correct.
Okay. Any other questions? Now, this is a public hearing. I've got a public hearing sign-up sheet and do not have anyone signed up to speak to this matter. Is there anyone here that would like to speak to the matter that we've just been discussing? All right.
Mr. Chairman, move to approve PB 1610, changes to the Currituck County UDO housekeeping 2016.
I second that motion.
Have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none. Opposition motion passes unanimously. All right. Under old business, A, we have a historical preservation report from the county attorney regarding the process to remove designated landmarks, landmark status of property under the historic preservation ordinance. With that, Mr. McCree.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. At your last meeting, as you considered the adoption of the historic preservation ordinance, which you did adopt, a question was asked, how would someone, if they had local historic landmark designation placed upon their property, somehow remove that if down the road they desired to do that? It was not clear that night whether the ordinance provided for that process, so I had a conference call with the with Ramona Bartos, Deputy State Historic Preservation Officer, and Scott Power, Eastern Regional Supervisor for the State Historic Preservation Office, last Monday to discuss that issue. After first warning that, from a policy perspective, that to allow for removal of a designated landmark from your ordinance would undermine the program, they then recognized, of course, that there was the ability for someone to have that local historic landmark designation removed from their property. Specifically, in Section 2-247 of the ordinance that you adopted at your last meeting, it does provide in paragraph A that the Board of Commissioners may adopt and from time to time amend or repeal an ordinance designating one or more local historic landmarks. And then it goes on to provide in paragraph B that the local landmark designation process may be initiated by either the commission or at the request of a property owner. So the process then would be the reversal of the process utilized to cause a property or structure to be placed in historic landmark status. That means that someone who wanted to have their property or structure removed could make application for repeal of the ordinance that caused them to be designated a local historic landmark. It would still have to go through the same process of the local historic preservation commission doing its study and report that the State Department of Cultural Resources have the opportunity to also review it and make recommendation. Those recommendations then be presented to the Board of Commissioners for consideration of an ordinance removing the property or structure from local historic landmark designation status. But the bottom line point is it is this Board of Commissioners which would have the ultimate decision as to whether to repeal the ordinance and remove the property from local historic landmark status, no matter what any other entity, the state or the local historic preservation commission, might recommend to the board. So that would be the process already allowed for in your ordinance that you adopted at your last meeting to cause someone's property to be removed from landmark status. Be glad to answer any questions.
So the decision would rest with the Board of Commissioners?
That's correct. As the decision rests with this Board of Commissioners, ultimately whether to even place a property or structure into landmark status.
Any other questions?
I think that satisfies the concerns that I had. As long as someone can remove themselves from it, I'm okay.
Okay.
Well, they can't remove themselves from it. They can apply to the Board of Commissioners.
I can't imagine a Board of Commissioners that would not do that. I'm sure there may be one, but at some point, but I can't imagine it.
Now, I would point out a minor consequence of removal, as the state officials pointed out, is that much like when use value is removed from a piece of agricultural property, the county would go back 3 years and collect the amount of tax that was deferred during that period of time.
So we don't need any action?
No.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Go ahead. No, no. And I don't know, Ben, if this is in your venue or not, but so the Board of Commissioners is going to approve ordinances adding structures into the historic preservation. What is the vehicle by which we're going to do that?
It's the same.
Mean, I've heard we have many structures that are eligible for that. I guess that's one of the things that the commission, the historic commission, needs to work out is.
They will be adopting some policy and procedure consistent with that which is laid out broadly within the ordinance. But it may be initiated by either the Historic Preservation Commission itself or the property owner. But each property or structure is going to have to go through this analysis, evaluation, study, recommendation,
and then come before us
with a proposed ordinance before the Board of Commissioners to consider adopting.
It'll have a recommendation from the local staff. It'll have a recommendation from the state. Department of Cultural Resources staff, then they'll have a recommendation from the Historic Preservation Commission. So you'll get three recommendations, but at the end of the process, it's the elected body's decision to either adopt or deny the designation, which also has a report that comes with it, as the attorney said.
All right.
Moving right along.
So,
Mr. Chairman, I do have one question. From the last meeting, we had the historic kite house up by the Currituck County Library that we constantly have to call to get the grass mowed and various other things done. I believe the gentleman that came before us was supposed to discuss with you, number one, that they did own it. I think he was uncertain about that. And number two, what their plans were for that house. Have you heard from him?
We did confirm that he owns the property that Amata Hoffler does, and he said he would respond to the county with his plan, which I have not received yet at the planning department level.
Because I know at one time there was talk of that house being donated to the county, and I don't think the county knows what they would do with that house if it was donated. But it is a historic structure, and I'm would appreciate a follow-up with him to find out what his ideas are in regards to that house.
I'll do that and get something to the board.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Okay. Anything further? Hearing nothing, we'll move forward to the next item. It's new business. It's consideration of an ordinance of the Currituck County Board of Commissioners amending Section 9-1 of the Currituck County Code of Ordinances regarding the discharge of firearms and Section 1-8 of the Currituck County Code of Ordinance providing that a violator may be issued a civil citation. Mr. McCree.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, this ordinance amendment comes to you chiefly as an attempt to clean up some language that was difficult to try to understand in the ordinance, especially related to the provision in paragraph D that spoke to the regulation of firing at targets. And while clearing up that portion of the ordinance, there's some other proposed language to clarify or to cause it to read consistently or better. I'll first start out with Section 9-1, paragraph A at line 21 of the proposed ordinance. That's just merely some language change, for example, to clarify that it's unlawful for someone to discharge a firearm within 100 yards of any regularly occupied residence not owned by them. That would be the new language. And then striking the word permission without their written permission and just changing that to without their written consent. In paragraph C, it's just a matter of striking the words shall be so that it will read it is unlawful to discharge a center fire rifle within 1/2 mile of any school, etc. Paragraph D is where there really was some modification made to try to clarify the intent and meaning of how someone may discharge a firearm into targets within the county. So what is proposed is an amendment that would then cause that section to read that it is unlawful for any person to discharge a firearm into a target unless they can meet the following three conditions. Number one, the point of discharging the firearm and the target are located 300 yards or more from regularly occupied residents. Two, a backstop is located behind the target sufficient to stop all projectiles shot from the firing line to the target. And three, the person discharging the firearm into the target has on their person written consent for the activity from all persons who are the regular occupant of the residence and from the owner of the residence if a different person or persons from the regular occupant of the residence located within 300 yards of a firing line and target. There's also proposed going on to line 45 on the next page a provision that would allow basically a grandfathering provision that would allow someone who has been discharging firearms into targets before this particular provision was adopted on April 16, 2007, and may continue to do that on their property so long as they're able to document that they indeed were discharging firearms into targets on their property before April 16, 2007, and there's been no substantial change in the use of their property. The next modification is in paragraph E, line 51, the proposed ordinance on page 2. There was a provision that spoke about the discharge of centerfire rifles in an area of the county not forested or woodlands, as the ordinance says, had to be done from an elevated position, that you had to be up in a stand or at least 10 feet off the ground or in the back of a pickup truck on top of a dog box at least 8 feet above the ground in order to discharge a centerfire rifle. The reason, of course, was in order for the projectile to be discharged toward the ground, but we started hearing some concern that persons may have difficulty then being able to sight in rifles or centerfire rifles on their property. So this modification would provide that someone may shoot a centerfire rifle in the two manner in the manner of 10 feet above the ground or 8 feet on the back of a pickup on top of a dog box, or if they have a backstop that keeps projectiles from leaving the property on which the centerfire rifle is fired, and that would allow for someone to be able to sight in their rifle without being a violator of this particular ordinance. Paragraph G at line 61 just again strikes the word shall be at the beginning and changes the word is. Paragraph H at line 64, it clarifies or specifically spells out some exceptions to this ordinance, some of which are found in the statutes limiting the county's ability to regulate the discharge of firearms, and a couple of others that are proposed because we know sometimes these type of events occur. So first of all, the exceptions are the use of firearms in the defense of persons or property, the use of firearms by law enforcement persons in the performance of their duties, the use of firearms in an indoor firing range, the use of a firearm for the purpose of shooting or killing any dangerous animal or reptile, the use of a firearm to take birds or animals pursuant to the wildlife regulations and the general statutes, the use of a firearm not involving the release of projectiles at a historical ceremonial function, so you could have reenactors or whomever discharging a firearm and not be in violation, the use of a firearm at school-sanctioned instructional or recreational activities intended to further the use of safe firearms practices, as we know that our public school system has such a program, and this will make sure that that program is in compliance with the county's ordinances. Moving on to part two of the ordinance at line 82 on page 3, this will amend section 1-8 of the Code of Ordinances, which is the penalty provision of the ordinance, and by adding the words section 9-1 to that section, it will allow for the immediate issuance of a civil citation by law enforcement or code enforcement officer, as opposed to the usual process with a civil notice of violation that would allow someone up to 30 days to come into compliance before issuance of the citation. So that is just another corrective measure to allow for more rapid enforcement if deemed necessary. I'd be glad to answer any questions.
Any questions?
Mr. McCree, line 42, where it says substantial backdrop, where we're taking that out, and now we're saying that it cannot be a substantial background. It has to be one that does not allow any penetration or continue through. Is that correct, is how I'm reading it?
Line 42 on what page?
I'm sorry. This would be...
You're talking about page 48?
Page 48, yes. Line 42, where it talks about a substantial backdrop, and now we're changing it to more or less read, you know, where it can't penetrate at all or cannot exit the backdrop.
Well, it's a backstop of whatever nature or kind, but that it is sufficient to stop all projectiles shot from the firing line to the target. So, yes, it is so that a projectile would not penetrate that backstop.
All right, so we're taking out the part where substantial doesn't say it can't penetrate. It just says that we're taking that part out.
That's correct.
Okay. And then the other section would be on the following page where exceptions, number 7, the use of a firearm at a school sanctioned instructional or recreational activities intended to further the use of safe firearm practices.
Yes.
What about a group or a organization that has a gun safety class and they want to have a safe firearm practices? I mean, is that something that we need to have something in here to...
If you want to add that this specifically would only relate to, as written, school-sanctioned events.
By school, it means public school or private school, not a school of instruction.
I think that's correct. If you want to, we want to clarify that if you want to allow any type of educational shooting courses, for example, to be an exception.
All right.
Okay. Any other questions? Observations? I've got a couple then. Always do. Section 9-1, line 21A, near residences. What circumstances did you envision when you wrote this as to why... What activity in shooting activity did you envision someone would be shooting closer than 100 yards to someone else's occupied residence that, let's say, we can't do target shooting, right? That's right now, as written in here, it's 300 yards. What other activity would you envision in someone within that 100-yard perimeter, less than 100 yard, what kind of shooting activity would you anticipate that this addresses?
Well, first of all, there is no modification made to this original provision in the ordinance except for the minor word changes. So I don't know what was intended back when this was first adopted. I suspect, and I've heard that there are any number of reasons perhaps why there was a differentiation in how close you could or could not shoot to an occupied residence versus shooting at targets. Some have said maybe it had something to do with hunting. I don't know if that was the intent or not. I suppose, again, that the type of shooting that might occur within 100 yards of a regular occupied residence that's prohibited as the ordinance is currently written might well be some kind of hunting activity or...
Mr. Chairman, I can address that. I was on the board when this was originally adopted. What brought this about was there was concern about deer hunters shooting their rifles. They don't do it like they used to, but they used to go along the side of the road and they would shoot deer. And so the county asked some of the deer hunters to get together with some of the staff and make some reasonable adjustments to what was allowed, which is why you got to the elevated height for discharging a rifle. That's what the deer hunters suggested. Then that way the bullet is traveling on a downward trajectory. And then the 100 yards, that was specifically because of hunting. If somebody was dove hunting or something in a field behind someone's house they had permission for or whatever, that was the course of the discussion on the 100 yards was for hunting.
Okay. So just a question. Since we require elevation centerfire rifles at more than 100 yards hunting, this appears to preclude that less than 100 yards from a house. I don't see anything in here indicating an elevation requirement. Speaking to, is that something we would want to address?
The elevation requirement, is only required when someone is discharging a centerfire rifle into an area not forested or woodland, which are defined terms in the ordinance.
Okay. I'm just asking questions to try to clarify so we don't have this create the same issue we had before, an ordinance that was virtually unenforceable because of the conflicts. And in Section D, subsection 3, it says the person discharging the rifle, handgun, shotgun, or other firearm into a target has on their person written consent for the activity from all persons who are regular occupants of residence and from the owner of the residence if a different person or persons from the regular occupant of the residence, here's the key, located within 300 yards. My simple reading of this indicates if you have permission from those people and you're not 300 yards away, you can target shoot. Right. Is that the plain reading of this?
I think that's correct, yes.
Just want to verify that. If you know, where did we come up with the 300-yard requirement for target shooting as opposed to the 100-yard for hunting?
I do not know that is as with the 100-yard provision in paragraph A, 300 yards is in the current ordinance and apparently was adopted April 16th, 2007. I do not know the purpose for 300 yards.
The reason I'm asking, I had staff provide just some random checks for other counties. Of course, there's 100 counties in North Carolina. I'm only aware of one other besides Currituck that has a 300-yard requirement. And I'm looking, this is random. I didn't pick this out. I got this from staff. Like Forsyth County, 100 yards. Guilford County, 150 yards. New Hanover, believe it or not, all it says is just be safe. It has no minimum or maximum. Durham County, 200 yards. and Cumberland County, 100 yards. I think in discussions we talked, the majority of the counties in North Carolina, those even more populated than ours, seem to have less than 300. So I was just, my question is, where did the 300 come from? And of particular interest, Currituck, as we all know, is geographically long but narrow. 300 yards requires a minimum of 58.4 acres in order, and that's a circle. Now, it may not, but that's what it's required, because as I read the ordinance, it doesn't say in any particular direction. So I think I'm safe to assume that it's in all 360 degrees, the requirement is that it be 300 yards. So that requires 58.4 acres. I had been to a GSI survey of the county, and it has remarkable impacts on some part of the county and a little bit less on others, but I think it's safe to say probably we're well over 60% of the county can't shoot. If you would put up that map of Lower Currituck, if you would look at that, and I know it's difficult to look, but look at the lower, if you could put your marker on that one spot, if you look, it's basically south of Foster Forbes Road. Those of you familiar in Lower Currituck, which is the district that I'm in, if you look, if you would put that cursor right on that, what looks like an hourglass, and the next one above it is near Kilmarlock, and that's on property that I think Jeff Newbern has a in around or near that. But the hourglass, and I'm just bringing this out, the hourglass section there where you can shoot, red meaning you can't shoot, the hourglass there just happens to be my property. And I looked at that, and of course I didn't know that, but I have enough land that that's why it is. If you go to Knott's Island, do you have the Knott's Island? I think Knott's Island is basically 96-97%. There's no shooting there. And if you go throughout the county, now keep in mind Currituck County is 50% wetlands. And so then along the corridor, all I'm just saying is I just point this out for whatever value it has or it doesn't have.
Mr. Woody, I can't find these maps in my agenda package. Were they not sent to us?
No, I made them at Commissioner Griggs' request.
Okay.
I was just, and I did, I asked Mr. Woody to do this because that's what I do. I look at facts. I try to figure out what the ramifications of this are going to be and how it's going to affect us. Now, here's some interesting statistics. I just toss it out here. By January of this year, we're going to have over 2,000 carry concealed permits carriers in this county. 2,000. In the last year and a half, we've had 563 permit issued by the Sheriff's Department, give or take, to buy a pistol. So now we're getting close to 3,000. This doesn't talk about those who already have handguns, and it does not speak to those who have rifles or shotguns. So we have a significant population of this county that basically, once an enforceable ordinance is put in place, there's really not too many places for anyone to go, except if they want to go to Camden when they get open their public range, or if they want to go to Stumpy Point, their county's range. So I'll also point out just demographics. The carry concealed permits, this county is issuing on an average, or not issuing, is receiving two applications a day for new carry concealed permits. In the month of November and December, it spikes by 7 or 8 a day. Now, I don't know why that is. I can speculate. I can speculate, but also demographics tell us that a significant increase in those carry conceal carriers and those applying are women. They're not some redneck who's out there, you know, with his Kalashnikov shooting into the air wildly, but it's women who, for whatever reason, feel the need to secure some form of protection. I don't know. It can be subject for, I don't know what the answer is. I mean, my thoughts are it certainly can be three things. It can be fear, uncertainty, or distrust that is creating this spike in carry concealed. And it's just not in Currituck. Fear. Fear for their personal safety. Uncertainty. We don't know where society's going. We hear every day you turn on your TV, you're hearing some tragedy, some issue. It's creating uncertainty and fear in people. And I think the third, distrust. I think there's a growing distrust among a segment of our population that doesn't trust government. And they're looking for some degree of I don't know, comfort, safety, or whatever. I don't know what the reason is, but there's a significant increase. We have nowhere in this county to go. Traditionally, I grew up in this county, probably the oldest. I am the oldest one on this board. And I shot all the time. I hunted all the time. I'll tell you, and I'm open for contradiction, more people have died in the back of Ted Kennedy's car than has died target shooting in Currituck County.
He was in the front seat.
By the time they found her, she was in the back. So I don't know what the answer is, but I know the step we're getting ready to do here is to create an ordinance that certainly can be applicable and can be enforceable. I just toss this out so this board knows the consequences of what they're doing.
I guess, Mr. Gregg, I mean, this has always been enforceable.
No.
It's certain sections of it until what we're doing is cleaning it up, though, so it takes away some of the areas that could be questioned.
I've heard comments, to your point,
yeah.
And if I could, I've heard comments that this doesn't change anything. Everybody's happy. Why are we even doing this? Well, of course, the language is problematic. I've heard we have no problems with people shooting. Everything's fine. I have here in my hand 17 pages of shot-fired incident calls from January of 2013, over 600. If my math is correct, that's 3.6 a week for the last 3.5 years. Of these, my best inspection of the data that I received, I don't know if anybody's ever been cited or convicted. Disposition doesn't show that there. It just says complied.
Does it say they're in violation when they shot?
If they complied, they apparently had to be in violation if they complied by stop shooting.
Just because someone gets a complaint about shots fired don't mean that anyone was in violation when they shot.
If you want to look at it, it just says complied. It just says complied. So I'm assuming, I could be wrong, and I don't presume to speak for the sheriff's department or the sheriff. My reading is if they complied, it was as a result of getting a call that was complaining about it. To better answer your question, they have no violation. I saw one or two there. They had no violation.
Okay. That's the reason I asked my question.
So, now I don't know all the internal stats of the Sheriff's Department. I don't presume to speak for them, but I think it's significant that we've had this many calls of shots fired. I throw it out there for whatever value it may or may not have.
I would like to clarify one thing. You said at Knox Island 95% or 97%. Keep in mind, the whole west side of Knox Island is surrounded by Mackey Island. There's no houses there. It's marsh. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. The whole east side of Knox Island is surrounded by the Currituck Sound. And I certainly, in my mind, can think of places to where people can shoot and be away 300 yards from somebody else's house.
I didn't just make that up. I had Mr. Woody. Can you show us the map? And I could be off when I said 96. It might be 94. It could be.
But I guess the big thing about it, if that was the case, last week they couldn't shoot there. Well, this week's the same thing. The distances are the same, correct? Mr. McCree, is that correct? I mean, is there any significant change to distances whatsoever?
The ordinance does not propose any change in distance.
There's none. Now,
if I could, Mr. Chairman, I think the point that Chairman Griggs is bringing up is that 300 yards when applied throughout Currituck County takes the vast majority of areas that are available for people to shoot, takes them, per the ordinance, legally out of play. And so if you look at that, and I think based upon the calls that are probably referenced there, the vast majority, and again, this is just an assumption, the vast majority of the shooting that is being complained on is probably occurring within 300 yards of an occupied dwelling or a regularly occupied dwelling. So I think the issue isn't what's today and what was yesterday. I think the issue is, at 300 yards, do we have an ordinance that is enforceable? Was a question that I think Mr. McCree was trying to clean up with some of the language that's associated with that. But it's if we're not really enforcing what's there today, because I'll tell you right now, I know that there's shooting going on within 300 yards of multiple houses in my close proximity. In fact, looking at the charts that you have, there technically should be no shooting of anywhere around me, with the exception of the grandfather clause that's going on. And so I think the point is, if it's not being enforced, does this board, should we be writing an ordinance that is enforceable? Or if we stay with what we have today, then, you know, what is the issues, or what are the issues that our sheriff's department has with being able to enforce the ordinance that is before us?
Mr. Chairman, can I say something?
Absolutely.
Could you please put the map back up there with all the pretty red on it? You know what you have in common around all that red area? People live there. I guarantee you, you could do a survey of every one of those people that live within those red places and say, hey, would you like a shooting range next to your house? I don't think you'd find anybody to say, I think we want shooting ranges next to our house. To say that we've got 600 calls or whatever, well, those are something that the Sheriff's Department can do something about. If you change the setbacks, then there's nothing that can be done, and then you think your call volume is something now, and then you're going to start getting a call volume from people where there's nothing that you can be done about it. Now, I do believe within this ordinance there is allocation. This ordinance has been in effect for years. It's not a new ordinance. There is nothing new being proposed tonight in spite of anything that's said. The only thing that's new is cleaning up the language. But it has a provision in it that you can have a range within 300 yards. All you have to do is get permission from the people that will be affected from it. There is a provision that allows it within 300 yards. But I can guarantee you, you can go do a survey in those subdivisions and ask folks, do you want a shooting range within 100 yards of your residence that's not regulated? It can go 7 days a week.
I don't think
you'll find a soul that would do that.
Shooting ranges.
No, I don't think it is.
This is recreational target shooting.
Recreational.
I think that shooting ranges are covered by a completely separate ordinance.
What is the difference in the noise from somebody on a private shooting range all day long and a commercial shooting range all day long?
I think a private shooting range all day long, this board has had those discussions about the regular and consistent and long-term, and I think that provides a noise nuisance that this board has addressed.
I agree.
A private going out and shooting all day long, I think, is covered under other areas of the ordinance. Or if it's not defined enough, then that's something that we probably do need to look at the definition of. But when you say a shooting range, okay, we need to be really careful about our language, because we're not implying by anything in there that you can set up a shooting range beside someone else's house.
And if you thought I implied that, I apologize. But if you're next to repetitious shooting all day long, it doesn't matter what the target is or what the range is, what you call it. And I will tell you, I do not believe that anybody that lives in any of the subdivisions in this county will come up here and say, please allow a private shooting range next to our house so we can listen to it on Saturday.
So, because they do.
With no noise abatement, no anything.
The next question is, and you just touched on it, are people afraid of their safety? Or are people upset about the noise? Because I'll tell you,
now that I couldn't tell.
9 times out of 10 or more, it's the noise. And that's not going to be addressed. And in fact, I meant to talk to the sheriff's department, because I would suggest to you that the decibel level of sound difference is not as great as one would think at 300 yards versus 100 yards. That noise dissipates fairly quickly, right? And I'm not going to suggest to you 100 yards is the number or 300 yards is the number. I'm suggesting to you that more information is necessary. If we want to address noise, that's one thing. But I think that's the intent of what this ordinance is stating, and I don't believe that's accomplishing what the desired effect is.
I just want to ask, because you asked some good questions about if you go out to a subdivision, how many people are going to want someone shooting at less than 300 yards in their house? I would ask you the same question. If you went to these same subdivisions and talked to the same people, how many of them want people hunting 100 yards from their house?
They may not.
Well, and does anybody on this board know the difference in the decibel? Was it higher, lower, between, let's say, 300 yards and 200 yards of the same gun being fired? Does anybody know? I kind of sort of know. It's about 5 decibels less, from 300 to 200. 5 decibels is a whisper. Road noise is roughly 45, 48 decibels is on that. Now, to your point, and I think Commissioner Beaumont hit it dead on. We look at something here, this ordinance, we're speaking to safety, and I've always thought about shooting that safety was paramount. Number one, trumps everything else. It's got to be safe. But we talk about the noise. And I have heard that anecdotally, the sheriff's department gets complaints about them shooting on their range there near the airport, and they're not shooting. It's coming from Blackwater. How far away is that? Eight miles? But you have hearing, I guess the point I'm making, noise is subjective. What we have here is we've got a lot of people, to Commissioner Beaumont's point, that shoot in this county and nobody complains. Neighbors don't care, whatever. Then you've got some people that complain if you're 2 miles away. They complain. So noise is a subjective thing, if you will, And we have an ordinance that not only deals with the decibel level, which is measurable, that's empirical. You can measure a decibel level. We also have a noise ordinance that speaks to your question, what if somebody's out there shooting all the time? Nuisance, irritating all of us. It's just not target shooting. I've heard people say, well, hunting, they don't shoot that much. You ever gone dove hunting? In fact, I would suggest to
that's
you.
That's how I know they don't shoot too much, because I've been.
I would suggest just from.
Didn't say if you hit anything.
That's right.
I would just say from a cursory review of the data that I've got, a lot of significant spike in calls comes from opening day dove hunting. Now, for those of you paying attention, I've never said anything about a distance, except the question where we get 300. I've not countered with 100. I've not countered with 200. I'm just laying out, if I can, in the context of what we're doing here so that this board understands and the people out there understand the context of what we're doing.
Well, Mr. Chair, let me just make a comment on this. My whole concern on this, not so much was the noise, was a safety issue. And I've expressed my concern to some of you here that, you know, I've had an individual shooting a firearm close by and had a bullet go through my house in the tub where we bathed our daughter. I didn't really appreciate that. And I understand, you know, and this was in the evening shooting. They just wanted to go out there and have a good old time. They were popping away, and here comes a bullet right through the back of my house into a tub. Okay, that irritated me.
Is that reckless?
That's reckless shooting.
Is that reckless? Well, people,
it is reckless, but my point getting back to is you got hunters out there that and I guess I'll speak for myself. I mean, you go through hunters, in my opinion, a little more safer out there than unless somebody's got firearm training, pistol training from range. You get somebody out there who hasn't any training, just gets a firearm for the first time, wants to start shooting away with a rifle, whatever, then yeah, you're going to be, I mean, no telling where that bullet's going to fly. But, yeah, the noise, I grew up in Currituck, duck hunting, dove hunting, you hear it every day around here. But the safety issue was just a concern of mine. But the point being, though, back to this, I thought we were addressing verbiage changes to clarify that up. Now, if we need to have a work session on yardage and get input on what people think on yardages, I think that could be another issue. But right now, we're voting on verbiage changes, and we got all into this big discussion on yardage right now.
Well, I think we did have a discussion at a workshop, a previous workshop, and there was no desire to deal anything with yardage. And like I said, I'm just laying this out here. And to your point about some yahoo shooting a pistol through your house, there's no law or ordinance that is going to keep reckless, irresponsible people from using guns, cars, hammers, or whatever recklessly. You can't throw the baby, I'd say you can't. Are we going to throw the baby out with the bathwater because there's a possibility you've got some, we have a sheriff's department. We've got an excellent sheriff's department that they can respond. One of the things that I was pleased to see in this, however this goes, 300, 200 yards, I'm certainly not advocating 100. But however it goes, what I was pleased to see is the backstop has to be sufficient to keep the round from leaving their property. That would preclude any bullets going through your house or anybody else's house. The sheriff's department is more than competently able to determine whether or not when they get a call if somebody is operating recklessly or carelessly with a weapon. There should be zero tolerance for that. Zero. Zero tolerance. You don't get a second bite at the app. That's my opinion. But anyway.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
If I may make a suggestion, and that would be that, you know, looking at the ordinance and the language changes, I agree with Commissioner Payment. You know, that's an issue that certainly I feel that we could this evening address. But I would like to put forth that we have facts to evaluate, you know, what is an acceptable range from a sound perspective that may alter the ranges that we have in this ordinance as it sits. That we're not trained audiologists. Would that be correct?
Close enough.
And to know what the difference between 5 decibels between 200 and 300, we really need to get more factual basis for that decision than just the group before us.
I have no problem with more facts. In fact, that's right in my wheelhouse. I like facts. I'm not an emotion decision maker. I like the facts. I have no problem with more facts. The reason that I brought this out is that some future board doesn't have to revisit this, or if we have a discussion, we can also have a discussion where if there are people that don't like shooting at all, we can have a discussion. You just want to ban shooting in Currituck, because there are some people that it's not the noise level. It's not whether it's loud or not, because I'm not aware of any information in my possession that shooting would violate our noise ordinance as it's done. There's just some people that don't like shooting. They don't like guns. They don't want to hear it at all. Period. They just don't want to hear it at all. There's nothing wrong with that. I mean, I respectfully disagree, but their opinion's as good as mine. So if we want to have a discussion about, I mean, there's all sorts of things we can discuss here. I just wanted to bring these facts out so that we make a considered decision, that we think about it, and however it comes out, that we just make a considered decision based on facts and not speculation.
Now, I'll just make one last comment. I would like for the facts to be shared with the entire board before the meeting going forward, please.
These facts that I've got, I got these on my own. That map up there, I've shared that with virtually, I've shared the general restrictions of what this GIS map with, I think, virtually all the commissioners here.
First time I've seen it, but I'd appreciate having the information ahead of time next time.
Mr. Griggs,
yes.
I would just like to say, I mean, as you, I was born and raised here. I've hunted everything there is to hunt. I've shot, and I totally understand people like to shoot, have a right to shoot. But back when I was a boy growing up, it was on Nair Shore, there was 10 houses off the whole Nair Shore. I mean, now go up there and look at it, subdivision after subdivision after subdivision. And I certainly don't mind taking it to the people and let the people say what they want. Sure, and that's fine with me. I'll be glad to do that. But base it on what the needs and wants of the people in our community are, and that's fine. If they say 100 yards, it's fine by me, because that'll allow me to shoot on my property again.
Well, so. You know, I mean, this is an issue, if I might submit this. This is an issue that there's very few people in the middle. You're either for it or against it. It's just one of those litmus tests. It's one of those. And reasonable people can agree to reasonably disagree. Oh. And the shooting, I'll tell you, I'm out in my yard. You just see the map there. The people shooting around me are shooting on the old ordinance illegally, and they'll be shooting illegally on the new ordinance. I've been shot at. Every time I hear a gun go off, I look up, see what's going on. I mean, and then maybe I'm starting to look the duck on, but I've been shot at, so I'm aware of it too.
Well, just, I mean, you're right. There's you're either for it or you're against it. And quite frankly, I'm for it when I'm doing the shooting, but when I'm sitting in my house on a Sunday afternoon and my neighbor over here has got a case of shells and 500 skeet and 5 buddies are shooting for 5 hours, I'm against it. So.
And that's a good point, and I just want to, and Miss Laura, I apologize. I apologize. I spoke to her before. Everybody's for a park until it's next to their house. They're good for it if it's next to somebody else's house, and they're good for it. So it's just not shooting. It can be a lot of things. It can be a lot of things.
And I discussed with you, if there was a way to where the in total repetitiveness to where there would be some limits as to how much someone would have to put up with, I certainly am willing to have that conversation. And I think I expressed that to you months back. So,
Mr. Chairman, would it be appropriate to go ahead and move to approve the ordinance as written tonight, knowing that we're going to discuss this again in the future?
I don't have a problem. That would be the pleasure of the board.
Well, I think that was a motion.
I'll second
so
it.
So we can move on.
Second.
Okay. All in favor, aye.
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 Opposed? All right.
The board understands again that because it was not a unanimous vote on this first reading, it will need to come back to you for a second reading.
Who said? I didn't hear a nay.
No. No, I mean, I did it. Let me clarify this.
I thought I heard a no.
If we're going to pass the language as written with a revisiting and discussion of the distance, I'll support that. If we're passing the ordinance as written, I'm opposed to that. He did. He did.
I did say that.
He did. All right. We have next item is board appointments. Board appointments, historic boat, and building advisory. Did you chance to talk to Cliff?
I did not.
Mr. Chairman, I did speak with Mr. Wilson Snowden, and he said he would be more than happy to serve on the historic boat restoration.
I also spoke to my person, and this time they declined. They hope to be able to do it in the near future, but at this time they would have to decline.
So we have one left.
So if what I'm hearing now, we could move forward with Mr. Snowden, if you want to proffer him tonight for our consideration.
That's what I was doing.
Second. For Mr. Snowden.
All in favor, aye.
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 Opposed? Hearing none in opposition. Motion. Mr. Snowden is hereby placed on that board.
Consent.
And now, next item is consent agenda.
Chairman, item number 6, determination program of voluntary removal of dilapidated structures. I know that we had identified 50 along the 168-158 corridor, but do we have any numbers to say how good this program did?
We do, and it was sent out, I think Mr. Scanlon sent it out to us.
Yes, sir. We sent out a report to you probably in the last week, 2 weeks, within the last 2 weeks.
And can anybody find it?
I don't have it pulled up now.
Could you just, for the public's
I can
notice?
Resend it. I mean, I don't have it in front of me, but that was one of the questions I think the commissioners asked, and we sent you some data on how many structures were in the program, how many successfully were demolished, and what the cost of that was. That was, I don't have that information in front of you, but that.
How about the tonnage? Do you have the tonnage of debris?
I don't
have that neither.
I don't.
I think all of that is contained in the report that the building inspector gave us.
I think so too.
I'm looking here quickly to see if I can find it.
I have the information available. It was.
The rescue.
26 structures were removed under the program. Of those, $79,000 in vouchers were issued. Of that voucher amount, $53,000 was actually used. So the basic summary is that the program paid for $53,000 in vouchers to remove 26 structures related to it.
So average about $2,000 per structure.
Well, in my opinion, it was quite successful in encouraging and helping clean up some of the dilapidated structures along the corridor. It was a successful program.
Commissioner O'Neill, do you remember when I first got on the board, we talked about this because apparently previous iterations of this program had failed when they got started because of resistance or whatever. And the idea at the time, correct me if I'm wrong, was to provide a degree of incentive to get past the inertia of people who were reluctant to clean up dilapidated structures. And to that end, I think it's been accepted. I think it's been accepted well, and I concur with you that I think it's been a success.
Mr. Chairman, I'll move to – is any other – you done?
I'm done. Thank you.
Move to approve the consent.
I second that motion.
Have a motion and a second. All in favor, aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none in opposition, motion passes to adopt the consent agenda. Commissioner's report. Commissioner O'Neill.
Do we have an update on the request for the no-wake signs or information in the Coin Jock Canal yet?
We are sending a letter to WRC requesting to increase enforcement, and the county is ordering signs to put additional signage out on the pier that we just constructed on the water side. Okay. We're starting a project on the Veterans Park, and we'll have additional signage placed on those facilities also when they put in.
Excellent. And next is the Highway Patrol in Currituck County. Our deputies are working all the wrecks. We've had 7 fatalities in Currituck County this year. And I believe that our Highway Patrol is understaffed, and I believe it's been understaffed for quite some time. And I know from time to time we make requests, but our deputies need to be doing the work that they are to do as law enforcement in Currituck County. We really need to lobby, write a letter, do something to find out what the staffing level for Currituck is supposed to be, how many were short, and what their plans are to fill the slots. It's my understanding that Dare County has a full contingent. Now, this is what I was told by a law enforcement person today, that Dare County not only has a full contingent of highway patrolmen, but they also have extra summer help in Dare County. Now, you look at Dare County versus Currituck. In Dare County, you've got a sheriff's department, got
police department.
You got Manio, Nags Head, Kill Devil Hills. You have 5 police departments in addition to a sheriff's department and a full contingent of highway patrolmen, and no traffic fatalities this year, where if we've had 7, not that the highway patrol would prevent the fatalities, but our deputies are spending quite a bit of time working traffic. And the highway patrol needs help. The guys we have here, they do a great job. They're wonderful folks, but they need help. And we need to contact our representatives and start lobbying on behalf of our traffic issues here in Currituck County. So unless the board has a different opinion, I think that we should ask staff to get that information for us.
I think it would even be better if you had a joint letter and have the sheriff involved in it as well. Get her to buy into it and send a letter from the county and the sheriff.
As an example, in Corolla, you have 50,000 people up there a year. A week. 50,000 people, give or take.
Different ones.
Different ones each week. And I don't think you have a highway patrolman that even goes up to the ramp in Corolla.
Only time you see one on the beach is if there's been a severe wreck of some kind.
Yeah. So I'm not complaining about what the guys we have are doing. What I'm doing is advocating on their behalf, and I think we need to step up on their behalf as well as our sheriff and our deputies.
Commissioner O'Neill, I think to your point, not that I'm advocating necessarily for Dare County, but I think both counties, and particularly us, but I think even Dare County, neither one of our counties have enough troopers to deal with the tremendous influx of traffic that both counties. Now, I'm not advocating that we do a letter for Dare County. Dare County certainly can do that for themselves. But
they have extra help in the summer. They get extra patrolmen in the summer.
Yeah, and they have a substation there. Do they not? They have one in Kill Devil Hills. They have a first sergeant assigned there all the time. So, I mean, the traffic issue, we've talked about it. As Commissioner Eidlett would say, we've admired the problem. We've asked. We've talked to the county. We've done it. Not county, the state. We have a tremendous traffic problem in this county. And now Moyock is experiencing some of the joys of the tourist traffic, blocking intersections so that people can't get out. And I think it would be incumbent upon us, and I would suggest to the new board coming in, to keep going to the state and saying, hey,
help.
Tourism brings in billions of dollars into the coffers of the state. Give us a break. Give us the troopers that we need temporarily in the summertime.
We should not be understaffed in Currituck County, period.
Do we need a motion for Mr. O'Neill's suggestion?
Dan, you know what we're asking you to do, so I'll just make a motion that you carry it forward.
Yes, sir.
All right. Do we need a second or just
second?
All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Hearing none, opposition. Motion passes unanimously. Commissioner payment?
Well, first of all, I'll just kind of piggyback on Commissioner O'Neill's about the accidents. I mean, I know Lower Currituck, their volume this year, and of course I'm on there, it's just it's unreal the amount of traffic wrecks that the Lower Currituck volunteers go into. I know Moyack's picking up as well, but yes, mostly the deputies out there, you're right, with the volunteer fire department waiting, you know, for the hybrid patrol to show up. But it's you know, it's tough out there. And just go back to the fire departments, you know, especially in the summertime. I mean, if you can volunteer, they need people out there. If you can just direct traffic, I mean, you don't have to suit up and fight a car fire, but geez, I mean, directing traffic, I went to one on Sunday. We had a head-on collision down there, and just keeping that traffic flowing was, I mean, you know, just waiting for everybody to show up, wreckers and all that. It's traffic's picked up, but it's a mess down there. So please, if you can help the volunteer fire departments in any way, I mean, they help and they work well with the sheriff's department. I mean, you see them out there both working together, and it's great seeing how the camaraderie is with these departments. Secondly, I just want to, and I hope I don't steal Mr. Commissioner Eilis under here about the softball, but I know I just want to say our youth rec teams are doing well, and I just want to give them accolades. I was following, especially the U girls, the U8s and U10s, and yeah, these past 2 weeks when it was 97, 114 degrees heat index, they were playing 2-3 games a day, and these U8 girls softball team came in second place. They were in the championship game, and they gave it all they had. And I just commend the coaches, our rec department, for getting the girls there, and U10 did a great job too. But just our rec department is doing a great job helping support our youth out there, and they're having a great time, and our coaches as well. I just wanted to commend everyone involved with that. That's all I got.
Thank you, Mr. Gilbert.
Just want to update you on a couple things. Currituck Kids, we are back in our fundraising mode to raise money for the kids in Currituck. And we've got two activities coming up on October 15th. So just mark your calendar. We're having the first annual Scarecrow Fest. And this is where you can come and make your own scarecrow. And they will be judged, and it is a fundraiser, but it's a great opportunity for a family event. So just mark your calendars for October 15th. There are more details on www.currituckkids.com. And then also, it's time to get geared up for the Gobbler Jogger, where we have the 1 mile fun run and then the 5K, and that is going to be on November 5th. So you can start gearing up now for the Gobbler Jogger and help raise funds to keep in Currituck County. Again, you know, I'm on the Board of Trustees with the Currituck Kids, and the overhead is very minimal because all of us that are on that board volunteer our time and our finances. So I just encourage you to go to CurrituckKids.com and look at the activities. There's opportunities for sponsorships. So if you will, just try to give back to, and if you have some time and you want to volunteer with the kids, between the animals and the kids, you can contact me and I'll hook you up. That's all I have tonight.
Thank you. Commissioner Beaumont.
Nothing this evening.
Commissioner Hall.
Just a reminder that as temperatures are soaring during the summer, especially with the heat indexes, our animals are out there, folks. Please remember, you know, if you see your neighbor's dog doesn't have water or cat or whatever it might be that's outside, try to remind them about it. You know, try to remember your own animal. Also, putting animals in cars. Please remember, again, putting the window down 2 inches is not acceptable with the car not running. If you need to, folks, call your local law enforcement if people put these animals in the cars. Same thing with, you know, children, anybody else that cannot protect themselves or may need help. Please remember these temperatures. Cars are not a safe place with the windows up or even down 2 inches. Thank you.
Thank you. Commissioner Eilis.
Just ask everyone to pray for the family that lost a little five-year-old child over on Corova yesterday, struck by lightning and killed yesterday afternoon. Sad tragedy, but... And Mr. Scanlon, I talked with you some about the parking lot issues at Knott's Island, so I hope you'll get somebody to take a look at those and try to do some upgrades. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you. I have nothing tonight. County Manager's report.
Yes, sir. We are starting to do the work to repair the boardwalk and bulkhead at Veterans Park. In fact, I believe they might have actually started today. To expedite that project and to keep the public safe, we've actually closed that park to the general public, and it will remain closed until the project is complete, which has been estimated to be approximately 3 months, and that should have started today. As was briefly mentioned today, I would encourage the general public to go to the county website. We have had two community meetings. When the Moyock Small Area Plan was completed, the number one priority for that community appeared to be the development of a community park. Staff has gone up into the Moyock community twice now to have a public meeting on the development of that park, and it has been mixed receive, I guess, is the best way to say it. But there appears to be a significant amount of opposition to the plans that we're putting forth. So we have developed, in response to that last meeting, a questionnaire that is on the county website. It is a public park. It is available for all the communities. So we're actually encouraging anybody in Currituck County to go and take that survey, and it can be accessed off the front page of the county website. And lastly, the Knapp Early College starts session a week from today on the 8th. So we will be back to seeing school buses back on the road as we talk about traffic on our roads.
Summer went, didn't it?
Yes.
All right.
Public comment.
Yeah. Does that conclude the
yes, sir.
Commissioner's report? All right. Next on the agenda is public comments. I have one person signed up. Please note that the limit on public comment is 5 minutes. And with that, Mr. Wheeler.
Good evening. My name is Jim Wheeler, 191 Beechwood Shores Drive.
First thing I want to say about Mr. Griggs, you commented about the calls for shots or shootings and this type of thing. About 2.5 years ago, we had one, and I know this because the guy was brought before me. Shots fired. He was hunting, he said. Shot through a trailer in Tolls Bay Colony. Just missing a couple of kids, and he was charged criminally with that. So as far as no charges being filed, that was incorrect.
Just as a question, was he charged under the county ordinance? Was he charged for
county ordinance, district, and state both?
State,
both. He was not 8 feet above the ground. He was said he was deer hunting. He was also charged for discharging a firearm into an occupied dwelling.
Yeah, I would think this not only the county ordinance, yes, but the state is both the one that's got both the hammer.
He was. All right. At the last meeting, I think it was the 18th of last month, Mr. Idle stated that there were citizens from Knott's Island and Corral and Corova came to the meeting when something concerning them was on the agenda. I think, and we didn't get a chance to comment after the comments last time because it was changed around, but I think if we're talking about the meeting time, I think that would concern the people of Knott's Island, Corova, and Corral. They should be here saying, no, we wanted to stay at 5 o'clock. But nobody showed up. The only people that showed up was me and Mr. Krodick. Mr. Krodick lives in Knott's Island. He said he wanted to change back to 7 o'clock also. That's one thing that I saw. Nobody spoke up that said they wanted to stay at 5. Mr. Beaumont stated 9 out of 10 people contacted him, wanted it to stay the same. They wanted to stay at 5 o'clock. There again, they didn't come to the meeting. Don't understand that. You know, I find it hard to believe that these people were contacting y'all stating they wanted to change to 5 and nobody's here. So I just want to state how I feel. I feel that some commissioners do not have the best interests of the people of Currituck County in their mind. I think you have a high position in the county government. Once elected, the people don't matter. One more thing. There was a meeting in Moyoc last week, I think it was, concerning the possibility of putting a park in Moyoc. There were 40-some people attended. Ms. Gilbert did not. Somebody said the only reason she didn't attend, it wasn't close enough to the election. Thank you.
Mr. Wheeler, I'd like to address that. I was actually scheduled at another public hearing meeting that evening, so that's why I was not at the park, Rick.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Wheeler. I don't see anyone else signed up for public comment. Is there anyone here that would like to speak? All right. What I'm going to do is recess the regular meeting of the Board of Commissioners and call to order the special meeting of the Travel and Tourism Board. And with that, Ms. Kugler.
Good evening. Thank you for having me this evening. We're going to talk travel and tourism. I just wanted to meet with you tonight just to kind of give you an idea of what's been going on this past season and some of the milestones that we've achieved in travel and tourism. Our new website was complete and launched in February, and I'm going to try to bring that up for you. Let's see if I can get to this one. Would you help me out here, Leanne? So this is our new website that we launched in February. There's a lot of wonderful things to see on it. Just wanted to point out, too, that we had talked before about some of the videos that we were doing with our locals, Discover Our Currituck. So we have a lot of different interviews with people, a lot of different videos to see. For example, if you hit the wild horses, get a little bit of that. You can click on the video and see that. So we're really proud of that. We've got 7 so far up, and I believe we've got 3 or 4 that we're working on that we should have pretty soon. See if I can get back into this now. Okay, another milestone that we reached is we now have all of our billboards in place. The billboards that we have going south feature beach destinations and activities. So as people are going down to the beach, they can see things to do, places to go. And all of our billboards going north feature mainland activities for the most part. And the reasoning behind that is people, as they're going down to the beach, they're not really thinking about anything but getting to the beach. And we want them to see things that they can do when they get there. However, when they're leaving, we're trying to plant seeds in their minds of things that they might be able to do on the mainland, such as Mackey's Island, the CCRC, having a wedding. So we're really kind of proud of that. I realize that, as we've discussed before, that we don't have any hotels to accommodate mainland visitors. But we also do have some wonderful destinations on our mainland. And we need to get that out to the people. We need to get that out not only to our residents who might not know about some of these things, but also to our visitors, such as we do have a sportsplex. We've got some wonderful fields coming on board this fall. So there's a lot of activity going on here, and we've got a product, and we need to market it. Maybe not to the extent that we market our beach, but we do have things that we want people to know about. Another thing that we've experienced this year is we've been hearing that a lot of our visitors and other people have been seeing a lot of our television ads in different parts of the country. So we're real happy about that. We've heard that they've seen our commercials in Boston, Philly, Charlotte, Winston-Salem, and many other places. So we're getting the word out. Another thing that I'm really proud of is this year we hired 10 interns for the summer. And seven of these were from Currituck. Five were high school students. Three of them graduated this year, three college students, and two postgraduate students. They function as tour guides, videographers, cornhole tournament and children's game organizers, and they were much needed muscle. They also gained some great experiences for their resumes, so we're really glad to have them aboard. We couldn't have done some of the activities that we did this year without them. We've also been working on building partnerships. We've been working with the WRC and the Lighthouse on doing joint events such as Halloween. We actually had a get-together where all the staff from these three places joined together. We had some pizza and had some great talk. We're currently working with the WRC to get a decoy workshop going. However, we're having just some challenges getting the bodies and some other things, but we hope to have that pretty soon. And we're seeking out ways to partner on programming and things that we can do on the grounds. We're also working with our property management companies and businesses on things such as the handicapped access that Currituck Club is providing and our South Beach access. We partner with planning to create a horse tour operators video for our horse tour operators at the beginning of the season. And we've been working with the Mustang Music Festival that's coming up in October at the historic Corrala Park. Had a lot of events. Memorial Day, we had over 2,000 people. July 4th, we were somewhat overwhelmed because we had approximately 6,000 to 6,500 attendees. It was a great day. It was just kind of wonderful. Upcoming Heritage Festival on September 17th, we'll have a Kansas City Barbecue Society nationally sanctioned cook-off, and the governor has just proclaimed it a state championship. And we're also going to have a rodeo. So we've got a lot going on that day. Not only do we have our traditional Heritage Festival activities, such as the antique tractors and music and trick riding and, I believe, a wagon ride and vendors and food, but we're also going to have these other two events on top of it. So it's going to be a great day. We're looking for volunteers from our county to help us out with that. And our volunteers will get our T-shirt and a food voucher, and they'll get to see the back workings of some of these events. We're also looking for sponsors to assist us with the cost of the barbecue. We do give out, there are cash prizes for the winners. So we are looking for sponsors. Heritage Day is free, and we'll have rock climbing, wax hands, trick riding, all that good stuff. Rodeo, the cost for adults is $15, $20 at the door. Children 6 to 12 or 10 and $15 at the door, and you can get these tickets in advance. Just call the tourism department. Now let's move on to historic Corrala Park. It's been a little over a year and a couple of months since the county assumed operations of historic Corrala Park. Our budget for fiscal year 2016 was $765,146. Our actual expenses, as you can see, was $657,795, and we were under budget a little over $104,000. So we were really pleased with that. Our revenue was a little, I knew we were doing well, but when you start looking at the figures, you get a little surprised. So we were real happy to see that our revenue for fiscal year 2016 was $176,981, and we also generated in sales tax revenue over $11,000. And Mr. Scanlon, I don't know if you had any other words that you wanted to add to that.
Yes, this is our first full year of the county operating Heritage Park. To kind of put it into some kind of a context, the final year that the trust was operating, they had an operating budget that was in excess of $1 million. And so we are almost $400,000, $350,000 less in total operating costs to run the facility. The other thing that's important there is when the trust was operating it, we were contributing $800,000 to that $1 million plus of operation. where because of the numbers that we generated here, we only contributed or only required us to contribute about $440,000. So that freed up $350,000 of occupancy tax that could be used and for other tourism-related projects throughout the county. So I think the staff is to be commended for the first year in the transition. It's we're actually seeing significant financial savings associated with the way we're operating the facility now compared to the way it had been. And I believe you're going to show a slide on visitations. And so we were able to do this, and visitations are higher than they've ever been. And I think she's going to show you that in a few minutes.
Can we go back a slide real quick?
Sure. See if how to. Thanks, Mr. Beaumont. Let me get back to that.
You didn't have to do that. Okay, so one of the things that just for the folks that are watching, so we had a budget, and you have expenses associated with the budget. The revenue of FY 2016 of the $176,981.89, that is in addition to, in other words, that comes off your actual expenses, correct? That offsets the county's expenses.
Correct.
So when you say you're 104 and 548 under budget, meaning where we expected to see while offset by the revenue, we're 104K ahead of the game.
That is
so
correct.
That is a cost savings to the county of 104K. In other words, sometimes sales or revenue can be misconstrued as part of the budget. What I'm trying to point out is, in fact, in that slide doesn't really, sorry, it doesn't do a great job doing that. But the point being, you know, you had your budget, the money that the county had put in from OCTAX towards that budget, we actually saved an additional 176K because we raised it in sales.
That's correct.
Correct.
That's the way to run a business. Thank you.
I just passed around this spreadsheet for you. It just sort of gives you a bird's eye view of what was going on from April 7th when we assumed operations to June 30th of that year, and then our last fiscal year. As you can see, in July 1st, 2015 to June 30th, 2016, we had over 18,000 people come through the house, in addition to 131 in the special tours, which are ghost tours and things like that. So we had a significant number of people visit the house.
Significant is not necessarily we've never had that many people go through the house.
And that was my next question.
If you go back and look at historically, I think prior to this, I think we hit one year, it might have been 15,000 was the highest over the last 10 plus years. So not only did we have these cost savings, but we saw more people than we've ever seen go through the building.
And to comment, didn't that took place on top of the fact that when we took it over, you cut the tickets, correct me if I'm wrong, in half, but we still made more money.
We took the tickets down from 12 to 5 at the beginning. In fiscal year 2016, we took the general tour up to 7, and 55 plus and children 5. So we did cut the ticket prices. I'm sure that contributed to more people wanting to see the house. But I think what's even more significant is that through social media and people coming to see it, word travels. I mean, we're all over TripAdvisor. We're all over Facebook. People come in and get a chance to enjoy it and see it, and they tell people about it. So I think that's why we're seeing our numbers grow, not only because ticket prices, but also because of the buzz.
One other comment I'd like to throw in. I did attend the art festival Under the Trees, and I went around and I spoke to vendors because I was interested, you know, number one, hey, thanks for coming for the county. What do you think? And the overwhelming response I got from vendors there was, in the previous 2 years, they had seen deteriorating attendance at that function, and in fact had reached the point of concern as to whether or not it would even occur, okay? And then after last year, they basically, you know, the general consensus was they held their breath and hoped for the best. And the one vendor made the comment it was the best art show he had ever participated in at the Corolla in Heritage Park. And he'd been coming for 25 years, I think is what he said. So he'd been coming a long time, and that was the best art show that he'd participated in. So,
well, we had two great event planners. We had Gina Martin, who did it last year for us, and this year she came back to help Kimberly Sawyer in her first year. So I give all the credit for that wonderful show to those two ladies because they just did a bang-up job. As you can see on the bottom of this spreadsheet, visitors to Whalehead from the time we assumed operations is about a little over 23,000. Whoops. Just a couple of things that are going on over there in Historic Corolla Park is we've started on our new restroom facility. We hope to break ground on that November 1st and have it completed by April 1st. This restroom facility not only has public bathrooms, but it has two dressing rooms associated with it, each one which has its own little private toilet. Its purpose is to serve the wedding venue out there to give brides a place to change. It's air conditioned. I think it's going to be a great amenity. I think it's going to bring even more people to the Whalehead wanting to have a wedding. And it will also be able to use for special events. So if we have a music concert going on, for example, and we have a headliner band that needs a place to change or get ready, or July 4th, we had the Air Force out this year, and they usually need a place to change, and they also have to have a command center. So they have to be in constant contact with their command. So that'll give us that opportunity to have that. We're expanding the parking and landscaping at this facility to prohibit the parking of vehicles on the lawn, which we've seen a lot of. So we hope to just make it a more attractive place. Also, we're in the conceptual phase for our boat facility. We've just started the planning on that. I believe currently we think that we have 8 of the restored boats that we want to put on display. And we've also received a quote to restore the guard boat. So we'll be pursuing that. The sidewalk, boardwalk that goes from the staff parking lot that goes down to the sound and connects to the bridge has been completed, and we're looking at expanding that and going to the next phase to continue that boardwalk. It's absolutely lovely. If you have not been down there, please go see it. It's just beautiful. I seem to have added extra slides. Just a little bit about what we've been doing with Whalehead is we've actually done a lot of acquisitions for the house, and the attempt is to give it more life, make it more lively. So we have purchased a Hepplewhite dresser for Mr. Knight's room. We're interpreting the Starkey's bedroom. We've got a lot of furniture coming in. We've acquired a lot of vintage clothing to put in the rooms. Last year, and that was precipitated because last year there was a little 10-year-old girl that had been touring the Whalehead, and I said, so what was your favorite thing about the house? Well, I like the old stuff. I said, yeah, but what was your very favorite thing? And she said, the dresses. So we got a lot more dresses. And we also have a new exhibit for children based on Joan Starkey. So we've acquired baby carriages, dolls, toys, and it's a beautiful little exhibit down in the basement. We've completed our signage at the park, and I'm just going to pull up a few pictures of that for you. That's our new historic Corolla Park sign at the entrance. There's under lighting right up underneath here. You can see that. And let me make that bigger for you. And that's our event sign right here, too, that lets people know exactly what's going on in the park at any given time. We did try to echo the wayfinding signage with the teal, and I think that's worked out really, really well. It's beautiful, it's simple, it echoes the lines of the bridge, so we're real happy with it. Events that we have in the planning stages, Tourism Awards Ceremony in November. We're looking at doing a 24-hour marathon at the new Community Park Center, possibly in the spring. And we're starting work on the 350th celebration of Currituck County. And one thing that we're looking at doing is possibly recreating Betsy Doughty's ride. And if you don't know about Betsy Doughty, she was a young teenager during the Revolutionary War period who heard that the British were coming and they were going to be in Great Bridge. So she hopped on her horse at night and rode 51 miles from Corolla all the way down to Perquimans County to meet with the general down there and tell him he needed to get himself up to Great Bridge. So that was a very young girl. So we're looking at possibly recreating that. And that's about all I had, unless anybody has any questions, anything going on.
I got a question for you.
Sure.
I was there. I come by there about 8 o'clock two Saturdays ago in the morning time. The grounds had loads of people there. Sitting out in lawn chairs around. I didn't see any activities going on. I wonder how much of that is people who were getting there early for check-ins later in the day on Saturday, just coming out and sitting under the shade and just finding a place to go instead of waiting and fighting the traffic as we left there going on back towards home. Once you got to Dare County, to Duck, it was gridlock. I mean, from there all the way across the bridge to Point Harbor, it was bumper to bumper. And I'm just wondering how many people are trying to beat that and come in there. And if that's the case, maybe we need to look at that and try to capitalize on that with maybe some type of function during that Saturday midday time frame to, I mean, I don't know, just an idea.
Yeah. I can't speak to that. I don't know if they're coming because they're trying to beat the traffic. I do know there's a lot of buzz about historic. I mean, we're getting the word out about historic Corolla Park, that it's a beautiful place. Whalehead Wednesdays have been exceptionally well attended. Even
just everywhere you looked out there, there was people. They had a cooler and had their lounge chairs, and just at 8 o'clock in the morning. Come
That's
on.
Great. That's great. We've done a lot of maintenance. I mean, you saw the expenditures. You saw our budget. You saw our expenditures. But not only did we bring more people into historic Corolla Park, but we did a lot of we addressed a lot of maintenance issues. We had to replace the roof on the gazebo. We had a bulkhead fall in last year. We had to replace that. We've done a lot of landscaping. So we've just done a lot of just maintenance on the park to just make it the kind of place that someone would want to come to on 8 o'clock on a Saturday morning with a cooler. It's a little early for me. I don't know if I would get out that early, but I'm glad to hear that you saw that, Vance. That's wonderful.
Chairman, I have a quick comment.
Sure.
You and your staff are doing a wonderful job.
Yes.
I hear nothing but praise from the rental agencies, people that interact, businesses. Just keep up the good work.
Thank you.
Everyone, the DU state chairman, when they held the facilities there, called me later on and said, what a first-class deal. So.
Thank you. That's all due to what we call Team Currituck. It's a staff. I have an amazing staff. I just get out of their way. They just take it. They run with the ball. We always call ourselves Team Currituck. And, you know, actually they call me the buzzkill, I guess, you know, being a director. But, you know, I try to accommodate them as much as possible because they have great ideas. One of them is a T-shirt gun. They said, we want a T-shirt gun. I went, oh. Do you really want a T-shirt gun? Yeah, we want a T-shirt. Well, I don't think so. Then I went and researched, and I said, okay, let's get a T-shirt gun. And they have had more fun with it, and our visitors have had more fun with it. But they just come up with great ideas, and I can't say enough wonderful things about the staff.
Keep up the good work.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Outstanding.
Thanks.
Outstanding. Any other comments or questions? Not hearing any, I'm going to close the special meeting of the Tourism Developmental Authority, reconvene the regular meeting of the Board of Commissioners. Upon doing that, I move the board enter. I'm sorry.
You have one budget amendment that we'd like for the board to consider before you adjourn the TDA meeting.
By all means.
You have a budget amendment there to support the next phase of the planning effort for the development of the economic development and planning efforts for the Moyock megasite, and you have a budget amendment to support that contract. We added, I believe there was comments from the board, part of the scope of this contract will be to look at the traffic flow on 168 from the state line to just below this site to see if there's any recommendations that need to be made as far as the traffic flows and the project that this might have, additional impacts it might have on traffic flow.
All righty. We need a motion to accept the budget amendment.
I'm looking for it on the budget amendment. Okay, I see it now. I've got it. Time at the end. Thank you.
So moved.
Second. All in favor? Aye.
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 Opposed? Hearing none, opposition. Motion passes. Now that concludes the Tourism Development Authority, and we'll close the special meeting of that, and we'll reconvene the regular Board of Commissioners meeting, and I will move that the board enter closed session pursuant to GS-143-318.11 sub A sub 3 to consult the county attorney in order to preserve the attorney-client privilege and to receive advice from the county attorney regarding the claim against the county and for the following pending lawsuit, Price Solar LLC v. Currituck County.
So moved.
Second.
All right, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none, opposition. Motion passes. We'll go into closed session.